we are all, we are intersectional feminists, and it's very, very important that, but I think if what raises, there are a few things which I would like to sort of share with you, because we thought that this, because when we organized this conference, of course, we thought that we are actually, we envisioned that this will provide a space to a feminist community. Okay, the non-feminist people who are not feminist were very, very welcome to become part of this conversation, but we were very clear in our, you know, conceptualization that this is a conversation amongst feminists, you know, because that is the space we have been conceding, you know, increasingly, and most of the time this discussion, discourse, conversations takes place, again, as I said, donor-funded, you know, kind of sites where people are not talking freely. So, so this was main idea, that we want to bring the feminist community together to discuss and reflect on the changing realities of women and the relevance of contemporary feminist theories and theory and practice. I think our both keynote speakers, Dita and Nilofar, has been constantly reminding us, I think they have been kept on reminding us, and rightly so, about the heterogeneity of subject woman. Navdita Menon's constant reminder about the difference among women, and then her call, in her quote, the keynote speech, when she said, her call that the feminists must continue to destabilize every category that has the claim of stability, I think is very instructive for all of us. However, it leaves me with some question, and maybe some of others also, there's some question in our mind, that we feel that if women as a category is so fragmented, then what is it, if not gender, then why that the large majority of women who are suffer from heteronormative brutality all around the world? So what is it which is defined, creating their similar kind of conditions, and why there is such a strong resemblance in the form of violation of their bodies, sexual abuse, patriarchal control and oppression, albeit varied but common. One wonders that which part of this fragmented category of women is out there that so often, as Nika Saeed Khan has mentioned, bring women in a universal demand for international recognition of women's oppression and exploitation at the national and international forums. I think it leaves us in thinking that how the divided feminist arrived at the conceptual understanding of the hierarchical social order that mirrors similar analysis emerging out of our different location and different cultural context, where there's so much similarity in that. Intersectionality of patriarchy, neoliberalism, religious fundamentals, I think fundamentalism kept on coming back in our conversation, I think the last 2.5 days. However, it appears that gender equality project of feminism is somewhere lost in the alley of politics. While patriarchal states and the global capital has not withered away, I think we have been constantly talking about state being misogynist, patriarchal, and we have heard many various speakers, I think it seems women have withered away in this process of self-reflection. I think it is ironic, while feminists are busy in subverting and erasing all kind of binaries, we are actively creating one amongst ourselves consistently. We have to, I think, in the absence of women as a stable category, we have to reimagine what are the new categories that can gravitate us to the project of feminism. I refuse to give up on feminism and the project of feminism, which is about gender equality. Gender equality is not about women's empowerment and women's equality. When the women will be free, when the women will be liberated, the entire society will be liberated. So it's not about women, it's about everyone else, you know, sharing, living in this world. However, it appears that gender equality project of, So as Afia says, we are quite used to minus one formula. Afia was telling me that, but let's not have minus one formula in feminism. And I really like it. We have to, you know, protect that this is, you know, this is the space, this is the theory, this which has a politics, and I think we have a higher stage to stick on to that. Feminists have been supporting and joining social movements, and that's again another point which I want to make, because being also in the left movement, and so for me, there are also a lot of issues there. So feminists have been supporting and joining social movements. However, they continue to marginalize in the anti-establishment struggles. Feminists are socialist, communist, environmentalist, peace builders, but these social and class movements are not feminist. Can the project of feminism can work in silo? Or will it work better by engaging with social movements of resistance, having kept our autonomy and autonomous status as well? We very much hope that we will continue this conversation amongst ourselves that might lead to a recovery of a woman. And Nandita, rest assured, we are not talking about the woman, the recovery of woman, which is like, that was stabilized, essentialized woman. But I think we are talking about a woman, recovering a woman with a new consciousness that could interrupt norms with new multi-layered gender consciousness. Intersectional feminism that brought the consciousness of difference and diversity among women should become the basis of unity and solidarity rather than being divisive. I think the brilliance of feminist thought is not merely an intellectual indulgence. It is important to see how this analysis connects with micro politics of resistance. Hence, theory and praxis must continue to inform each other in feminism. I think another challenge before us is, how do we engage in oppositional resistance movement of subalterns who are engaging with nation state and global institutions and holding them accountable all the time on their pronounced legal and political commitment, such as good governance and democracy and gender equality and so on and so on and so forth, because we may, willing to abandon or debunk or discredit or disengage, some of us may vote with the state or democracy and so on and so forth, but I think those who are living at the, you know, the marginalized, they have no option but to continue to have that engagement. So subalterns are in what we see, they are, and I think I fully agree with Nazish, she's not here, that because in the absence of any strong women's movement, in the presence of violence, especially non-state violence, I think people are turning to the state, whether we like it or not. They need protection. So what we, I think, subaltern, we see increasingly turning on their creators, who crafted rights-based narrative to couch the brutality of their own oppressive structures. People from the periphery, so I made that point which the Nazis has said. So I think what they are saying, okay, if you're saying, if the state is telling us that you have a right, you should have a democratic right to participate, in election, or you have a right of protection and security, so they are using the same narrative and they keep on coming, out in, protesting on street, which we see in Pakistan. I don't think I have seen so many protests in the history of Pakistan, if I go like for the, because I almost participate any protest which is happening, because I don't make any distinction that who is protesting. For me, the resistance, you know, whether it is counselors or lady health workers or teachers or lawyers or young doctors, you know, so we become like, because everybody is coming out to protest and demanding deepening of the democracy, and they are demanding the state must deliver, you know. And I think it is a kind of putting some pressure. So we hope that the collectivity of feminist analysis at the foundational level will lead to the collectivity of our politics of resistance and transformation across border. We wish lasting engagement with all of you and looking forward to continue to learn from each other's experience, tactics, strategies for social change. I think with that, I would like to thank once again for your interest and participation, especially I think all of you who are still here, and despite, I'm sure you all of you must be very tired, so I'm thankful to you, and I certainly wish a very safe journey to you who have to travel back home. And once again, I think I must congratulate my own center, my center's team, and gender studies student body for organizing the conference with such ease and professionalism. I'm not missing out on you. Okay, so so everyone, I think, has participated, worked hard. With that, I think with this kind of young faculty at Gender Studies, I have all the hope that they'll take this discourse forward. And I'm very thankful. Vice Chancellor has been a really big support. I think with this auditorium at one point, I think this conference, to be very honest, people have different experiences when they're organizing conference, tension, conflicts. I think our conference, I must say, it got so smooth, with the exception of only when this hall, we were not able to get in this auditorium because this hall needs some maintenance, and I think we are very thankful to the Vice Chancellor that he, despite that the hall was not in a position, he allowed us on a very, he asked people, department works, directions. Once again, thanks,
sir.
Thank you very much.
Especially for believing in us. And indeed, this was a team effort. And some of us were visible in front of you, but most of the individuals were not visible in front of you. That was the whole team of our Center of Excellence in Gender Studies. So I would like to now call upon Honorable Vice Chancellor Qaed Azam University, Javed Ashraf sir, for his vote of thanks.
Thank you very much. I had thought my role was just to smile and say hello to everyone and goodbye at the end. But I will say a few words. This has been a refreshing conference, I think. A breath of fresh air, if you will. For too long, I think this country has suffocated in many ways, and to have liberal thinking come to Qaed Azam University is a good change, and I would like this to be a start for other kinds of discrimination and suppression that we have in this country. It's not limited only to women. We see discrimination in terms of religion, for example. I am still relatively new in this country. I've been here 2 years now. But I think it's a shame for all of us when the Punjab governor is gunned down simply because he was trying to protect a Christian woman against so-called blasphemy laws. I think it is a matter of shame for us when churches are burned down again on trumped-up charges. I think it is pitiful that we see different groups within Muslims targeting each other, Shias against Sunnis, other groups against others. And I go back to words which we should all remember. Martin Luther King said, individuals should be judged not by the skin, not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. We have for too long had all kinds of prejudices. We have allowed ourselves to be what we are at this point. Two of my heroes were here today, Perez Hudbai, who sits here, and Perez, every weekend that I pick up Dawn and your article is not there, I'm disappointed. So carry on with, I do not think that there is a single issue with which I disagree with. Actually, there is one, but I won't say it publicly. And of course, Asma Jahangir was here, and we really need 1,000 Asma Jahangirs to take this country forward. So thank you very much for organizing this conference. I think that we need more conferences like this one to to address all of the prejudices and all of the closed-mindedness which unfortunately has become a hallmark of this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Vice Chancellor. Now I would like Dr. Farzana, Professor Nilufer, and the Vice Chancellor to come and to give the certificates for the volunteer team that have put their all of their energies in making this conference a successful conference. And I'm really proud, and I must say we all are very proud of all of the students that they have worked really hard, and I really want to call all those volunteers.